So conventional wisdom told us that coordination is very expensive, so that one, we want to avoid coordination as much as possible when we design distributed systems. So in this talk, I'm going to present NetChain, a lightning fast coordination system enabled by emerging programmable switches. There is almost no performance overhead for the clients to use coordination. Now, given that coordination becomes so cheap, it opens the door for us to rethink how we should design distributed systems. So coordination services such as Chubby, ZooKeeper, and etcd are a fundamental building block of modern large-scale cloud systems. They support a wide variety of distributed applications from data processing to data center management. Coordination services provide critical functionalities such as configuration management, group membership, distributed locking, and barriers. These various forms of coordination are typically implemented on top of a key value store that is replicated on multiple servers with a consensus protocol such as PEXAS to achieve strong consistency and fault tolerance. And the focus of this talk is how we can make this key value store high performance. First, let's take a look at the workflow of a coordination service. So the client sends a request to the coordination servers, and the coordination servers execute a consensus protocol such as PEXAS, and in order to commit the request to all the servers, and then they send a reply back. The throughput is bounded by the server NIC, and the latency depends on the consensus protocol used by the system. Typically, it takes several RTTs for the servers to agree on the decision. But no matter what consensus protocol is used, it takes at least one RTT to complete a request, because the client has at least to send the request to the servers, and the servers have to send the reply back. And I want to emphasize that the processing time at the server software stack dominates this latency, not the network delay. Now, given all these hardware limitations, how can we do better? Our observation is that the workload of distributed coordination is communication heavy instead of computation heavy. As such, servers as general purpose computing devices are not well suited to implement coordination service. Switches, on the other hand, are optimized for I/O. They provide orders of magnitude higher throughput and lower latency than a commodity server. Therefore, we propose an in-network approach for coordination. It replaces the coordination servers with high-speed switches. And such a solution provides orders of magnitude higher throughput than a server-based solution. Moreover, since the network delay is negligible compared to the processing delay at the client software stack, the latency to process a request is only half of an RTT. Okay, so it is straightforward to achieve high throughput and low latency, as they are directly provided by high-performance switches. But the hard question is how to ensure strong consistency and fault tolerance, given the limited functionalities and the resources of switches. NetChain realized a protocol called chain replication to achieve strong consistency and fault tolerance for the in-network coordination system. First, let me briefly describe what is chain replication. So chain replication is a classic protocol to build storage systems. The storage nodes are organized in a chain structure. It contains a head and a tail, and all the other replicas are placed in the middle. So to handle a read request, it is directly sent to the tail, and the tail processes this request and reply back to the client. A read request is sent to the head, is processed by each node along the chain, and then replied by the tail. By processing read and write requests in this way, train application ensures strong consistency and fault tolerance for the system. And it is able to tolerate F failures with F plus one nodes. We choose to realize train replication for the in-network coordination system because the division of labor of train replication is a perfect match to the network architecture. So in train replication, the storage nodes are organized in a chain structure and they are optimized to process read and write requests at high performance and providing strong consistency. And a train replication also contains an auxiliary master that handles less frequent reconfigurations, such as node failures or adding new nodes to the chain, and it provides fault tolerance. The storage nodes can be directly mapped to the switches in the network data plane, which process packets at a long rate. And the way that train replication process requests is simple enough to be entirely implemented in the switch data plane. And the auxiliary master can be naturally mapped to the network control plane, which handles network reconfigurations. And many data center networks already have a centralized, logically centralized controller that handles network reconfigurations. While the protocol for fault tolerance is more complicated, but it is also much less frequent as compared to processing read and write requests. Based on this idea, we designed NetChain, an in-network coordination system. NetChain leverages the high-performance switches to directly process read and write requests in the switch data plane at a long rate. And it leverages the network controller to handle system reconfigurations for fault tolerance. Well, such an in-network approach sounds promising. But how do we actually use switches and train replication to build a strongly consistent fault-tolerant in-network k-value store? It is traditionally considered to be very difficult to implement a sophisticated application-level functionality, such as in-network coordination, to run on a switch at a long rate, because switch ASICs were considered to have limited and fixed functionalities. In particular, how do we store and serve key-value items in switches? How do we route queries through switches according to the chain structure? How do we handle out-of-order packet delivery in the network? And how do we handle switch failures? So further three questions relate to the data plan, and the last one relates to the control plan. Fortunately, lots of the impossible things have been made possible by the emerging PISA or protocol-independent switch architecture. PISA aims to process packets at the highest speed under full programmable control of the user. As shown in the figure, a PISA switch data plane has a parser followed by a pipeline of mesh action tables. The parser converts packet data into metadata. And mesh action tables in each stage operate on the metadata and update memory state in massive parallelism. With PISA switch, we can program the parser to parse custom key value packet fields and program the mesh action tables to read and update key value data at a long rate. A network switch contains a control plane and a data plane. The PISA architecture I just talked about only defines the data plane, which uses a set of mesh action tables to process packets at a long rate to implement various network functions. The switch also contains a control plane that runs network management applications in a Linux-based switch OS. It manages the data plane using a runtime API through PCIe. To implement NetChain in a programmable switch, we add a key value store module to the data plane that processes read and requests at a long rate. And the NetChain controller manages the key value store module through a NetChain switch agent in each switch OS for system reconfigurations. Now let's go into details and start with the first question. How does NetChain store and serve key value items in switches? So as we talked about this earlier, a PISA switch allows users to program the parser to parse custom packet header format and convert packet fields into metadata for further processing. The figure shows the NetChain packet format to be identified by the switch parser. NetChain is an application level protocol that is embedded inside the layer 4 UDP payload. It is fully compatible with existing L2 to L4 layers. And the NetChain module in the switch is invoked by a reserved UDP pod, and it only processes NetChain packets. And the NetChain custom packet header contains fields for routing, operation type, sequence number, key, and value. We use register arrays built on SRAMs in programmable switch ASICs to store and serve key value items at a line rate. The match action table maps the key of an item into an index in the register array, which indicates the physical location where the value is stored. And based on the index, the action performs read and write operations to the register array. And the design of the key value store in a single switch is based on NetChain, which was published in SOSP 2017. And it provides an efficient solution to store variable length values using multiple stages. And NetChain is a distributed key value store built on multiple switches in the network. We use consistent hashing and virtual nodes to partition the key value data and assign the partitions to the switches. Okay, now given the ability to store and serve queries in each switch, how do we route queries through multiple switches according to the chain structure? So NetChain routing is inspired by segment routing. To send a request to NetChain, the client inserts a list of IP addresses of the switches in the chain to the packet header, and the destination IP is updated to the next switch at each hop. As an example, to send a write request to NetChain, the client sets the destination IP to S0, which is a head, and the network uses existing routing protocol to route the query from the client to the header switch. And the other two hops, S1 and S2, are contained in the packet header. SC, which is short for switch count, indicates the number of remaining hops in the chain. After S0 processes this query, it updates the destination IP to the next hop, which is S1. And similarly, S1 updates the destination IP to S2 after it processes the query. And since S2 is the last hop, it updates the destination IP to the client IP and sends the reply back to the client. Handling a read request is simpler. The client just sends the request to the tail, and the tail replies to the client. So notice that we also put S1 and S0 in the packet header, because if S2 fails, the network can still forward the query to the other two switches to process that query. Now the queries can be routed and processed according to the chain structure, but the network only provides best effort packet delivery. And the packets can be reordered when they are sent from one chain switch to the next. So how do we handle these failures? These are out of order deliveries. So this example illustrates the problem of out of order packet delivery. So we have a chain with three switches, S0, S1, and S2. And we have a key value item whose key is 4 and the initial value is A. And we have two concurrent writes that are going to update the 4 to B and C respectively. Unfortunately, these two writes get reordered when they are sent from S0 to S1. So the value of 4 at S0 is C, and the value is B at S1 in the end. And to make things worse, the two writes get reordered again when they are sent from S1 to S2. And as we can see that because of this out of order delivery, the value of 4 is inconsistent between the three replicas, compromising the strong consistency guarantee. So to solve this problem, we associate a sequence number with each key value item, which is inserted by the head, and it is monotonically increasing. And the read queries with lower sequence numbers are dropped by the following switches to ensure strong consistency. Finally, how do we handle switch failures in the control plane? So as I introduced earlier, NetChain uses chain replication, which is able to tolerate F failures with F plus one nodes. To gracefully handle a switch failure, NetChain divides the failure processing handling into two steps. The first step is fast failover, which removes the failed switch from the chain and resume and continue to process read and requests with the remaining F nodes. And now because the chain loses one node, it is only able to tolerate F minus one failures. And the major challenge for fast failover is efficiency, because we want to resume processing as fast as possible. It is too expensive to update all the clients in the data center about the new chain structure, because there can be hundreds of thousands of servers in a data center. And our key idea is that we only need to update the neighbor switches of the failed switch in order to forward the requests to the next chain switch. The next step is failure recovery, which adds another switch to the chain and restores the chain to tolerate F plus one failures again. The challenge for failure recovery is that we need to synchronize the state between the new switch and the existing switches. We use a two-phase atomic switching protocol to ensure the consistency of this process. And we use virtual groups that divide the key-value data into multiple groups and migrate one group at each time in order to minimize the service disruptions that may be caused by the two-phase atomic switching. So our protocol differs from the original chain replication in the underlying mechanisms to handle queries in the presence of best effort network fabric and failures. So to prove the correctness of our protocol, we keep the following invariant, which states that for a key that is assigned to a chain of nodes, if SI is the predecessor of SJ, we always ensure that the sequence number at SI is no smaller than SJ. And with this condition, we are able to guarantee strong consistency under various conditions, such as packet loss, packet reorderings, and switch failures. And so please see our paper for a TLA plus specification. We have implemented a NetChain prototype on a testbed with 4 Barefoot Tofino switches and 4 commodity servers. And we use P4 programming language to implement the switch data plan, which you can run on the 6.5 TBPS Barefoot Tofino switch. And it is able to support up to 100,000 items and up to 128 byte values. And the servers uses Intel DPDK to generate a large amount of query traffic to the system. To evaluate NetChain, we answer the following questions. Can NetChain provide significant performance improvements? Can it scale out? Can it efficiently handle failures? And can it benefit applications? And we show a few important results in this talk. So we first show the throughput of NetChain and compare it to ZooKeeper running on 3 servers. ZooKeeper can provides up to 150,000 queries per second. On the other hand, even if we use all our 4 servers to generate query traffic at a total rate of 82 million queries per second, they can still not saturate NetChain, regardless of the value size and the store size in the evaluated range. In fact, if we have hundreds of servers to generate the query traffic, NetChain is able to provide a few billion queries per second. In addition to throughput, we also show the latency of NetChain and ZooKeeper. ZooKeeper takes 170 microseconds to process a read query, and it takes 2,350 microseconds to process a write query. In comparison, NetChain only takes 9.7 microseconds to process a query, regardless of the query type, because the processing time in the switches are negligible compared to the processing time at the client software stack. Finally, we show how NetChain handles failures. We fill one switch in a three-switch chain, and then we add another switch to the chain for failure recovery. NetChain only takes a few seconds for fast failover, so that the chain can quickly resume processing the queries. Failure recovery takes a longer time because we need to synchronize the state between the new switch and the existing switches. So to minimize the service disruption caused by failure recovery, we divide the key value items into 100 virtual groups and migrate one group at each time. And this technique significantly reduces the throughput drop during failure recovery. So in conclusion, we present NetChain, an in-network coordination system that provides billions of operations per second with sub-RTT latencies. And given such lightning-fast coordination provided by NetChain, it opens the door for us to rethink how we should design distributed systems. And finally, now the Moore's law is ending. And in recent years, we see the emergence of specialized processors for domain-specific workloads, such as GPU servers, FPGA servers, and TPU servers. And we envision a new kind of servers called PISA servers that are enabled by the programmable PISA switch ASICs. And we believe that NetChain is only one concrete example of a new generation of ultra-high-performance systems for I/O-intensive workloads enabled by PISA switches. And with this, I would like to end my talk and take questions.
Are there any questions for our speaker today? Is there one there? Please, yeah. Is there a mic there? No, okay, let me get a mic to you.
Shankar from AT&T Labs. Mm-hmm. So one of the reasons why you basically sort of use a distributed key value store is for locality of access. So I was wondering how that sort of relates to the solution that you proposed here.
So your question is how does the locality matters in this in-network coordination?
Right. So how does the solution that you propose here affecting the locality? Right. So you basically used consistent hashing here, right?
Distributed. Oh yes.
So I was wondering how that sort of ties in with the entire scheme of things. If we were to use some other mechanism, would that really change the way you look at the problem?
Yes. So basically here, because the network latency is very small compared to the processing time at the client software stack in order to send a request and send a reply. That's why we simply use consistent hashing to partition the data. But we also discussed this issue in the paper that if you know about like which clients are likely to send a lot of queries, then you can decide your data placement policy based on that query traffic.
Follow up. So would that mean you change your routing accordingly? Because that seems to have an implication in terms of how.
Oh, that only changes the data partition. The routing is still the same routing protocol. The client just inserts the IP addresses of the chain switches into the packet header. Then we use the existing protocol to route the queries.
Yeah. Hi, Mina from Princeton. Mm-hmm. So I had a question about the reordering. Like you drop the request that are reordered by the network, right? So would that mean that the client request is going to time out? So you wait for the client to time out and then resend the request?
Yes.
So that wouldn't, like is there a way to remedy that? Because then any reordering that happens would mean that the client should actually wait kind of a long time to time out and then retry, which wouldn't happen if you were doing it on the servers, right?
Yes. So basically, in the current design, we drop the query, but the client can also, at the same time, issue some real queries. If they see the value is updated by some other clients, they may change a little bit of their processing logic.
I see. So you want to, like, to remedy this, you want to rely on the client to
reads
at the same time while it's doing writes?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you.
Hi, Shin. Dan Ports, now Microsoft Research. Really great work. I like this a lot. So
thank you.
My question was about, since you're storing the content on the switch data plane, how much storage space do you expect to have available, and will that be enough for coordination applications?
Yeah, that's a very good question. So currently, we can allocate around like 10 megabytes of storage in each switch. And then with more switches, you can definitely get more storage. But I think the key is that for many of these coordination services, they are not looking for a huge amount of storage, but they are mainly used to store only the most critical data, such as some logs or such as some like configuration parameters. And those are usually very small data, and you can actually store a lot of this kind of stuff into the limited switch memory.
Sure, that makes sense. Thanks.
Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah, Pohan, also from AT&T. So you mentioned the reason you chose the chain replication for NetChain is it's best matching for the network topology.
Yes.
Did you compare the performance of chain replication with other coordination technologies like PackSource and Raft? Seems to me that the performance for writing is high because you need to try all the nodes in the chain.
Yeah, but even you use other consensus protocols such as PackSource, you still need to commit that request to all the nodes in the system. And also, the reason that why we choose chain replication is that the way that the chain replication handles the requests is simple enough to be implemented in the switches in the data plane. While if you use some other protocols, it's more complicated, and you may not be able to implement them entirely in the switch data plane.
But there are also proposals like the NAT PackSource.
Yes, for NAT PackSource, they still need some processing under the servers for that. We have this in the paper. You can take a look.
Yeah. All right, so one last question, and let's make it a quick one.
Murat Demirbaş, SUNY Buffalo. So the master, the network control.
Yes, yes.
Is this PackSource replicated?
Yes, that one is PackSource replicated. And because it only handles less frequent reconfigurations, so that's okay to run on PackSource on the servers. Yeah.
All right, let's thank Shin.